Your Sunday prayers. Page 7.
You are born on this earth. You gave yourself humans. You were born on this earth and strived sincerity. I speak in this world to you who are wise and unprostrated. With human bodies formed to you from the pure, whose emotion like a golden mountain, the name that blazes in the three worlds, winner of death and war, and to you who are prostrated. With the supreme signs, the faithless father's moon, follow my gold to you I am prostrated. That's why to you I am prostrated. The Savior having great compassion, found that I am all understanding. The people of primary qualities of the last solution, and you who are God of justice, I prostrate. The purity and the freedom of our attachment, the virtue and the peace of my humble lower arms, one path is the mind of your reality, the divine and the natural, I prostrate. Those who are liberated and lost are the path of liberation.
Praise the rain of last profound. All
Lama. The 80,000 types of instruction types of life, free from matters and harmful conditions, they all belong to the universal river of consciousness, bringing happiness and well-being to your life and now.
Wow.
So.
Let's start with a short meditation on the breath, just to calm and center our minds. So sit in a firm but comfortable meditation posture. Bring your mind inside, away from external objects and distractions, and also try to keep it away from internal distractions, mainly the discursive, chattering mind, wants to think about everything, which is to be focused on your breath. And we focus on our breath as it exits and enters our nostrils, right at the entrance of our nostrils. You can just feel it gently coming and going there. You don't have to breathe in any special way, just breathe normally. But pay attention, and complete attention, full attention to your breath. Focus on my breath for a few minutes without allowing myself to become distracted by anything whatsoever. And with that determination, focus fully on your breath. Stay focused on your breath. ask yourself, why did I really come here? For different reasons. But if the main reason is that you're here just for some, seeking some temporary benefit, just something for this life alone, and that's not really a positive motivation. It's a worldly motivation, it's not a spiritual motivation. So even though what you hear is not really enough. In terms of spiritual motivation, Dharma, you know, the teaching of the Buddha, the Dharma, that which protects us from suffering. Spiritual motivation has to be different from ordinary worldly motivation. That it just looks out for this life. One might even, in such a worldly motivation, might serve to this life isn't all there is. There are infinite future lives, so we have to do something to benefit those while we understand that reality and have a chance to actually do something about it. After we die, we can either be reborn in either the upper realms of cyclic existence or lower realms, such as animal realm or spirit realm, the hungry ghost spirit realm, or the hell realm, the state of deepest suffering. Or in the upper realms as a human or as a god. And for most of us, those are the choices we have upward. So at least we should shoot for upper rebirth, like another human rebirth, and not be reborn in the lower realms, from which it's extremely difficult to escape, even though we've managed this time. So if that's our goal, just not to be reborn in the lower realms, if That's the least level of positive motivation. And we can say, well, I'm here this morning. So just because we have to continue to follow it, we can recognize it as short-term, negative, undesirable, and then replace it with a positive motivation. No, I'm here in order to get, not be reborn in the lower realms, to get another human rebirth, at least so that I can continue studying and practicing Dharma. And we can replace our worldly motivation with that one. That doesn't really, you know, as we know now, the suffering of birth, aging, illness and death, not getting what we want, losing what we have, meeting undesirable circumstances, and just being in this body, which is the product of delusion and karma. And, you know, just serves as the very basis of the various sufferings we experience. So to be born in a situation like this again, doesn't really solve our problem. However, as the Buddha taught in, you know, the Four Noble Truths, that this conditioned existence is fraught with suffering. That suffering has a cause, delusion and karma, and at the root of that is ignorance of not understanding the law of cause and effect, karma. And positive actions bring happiness, negative actions bring suffering, and not being able to discriminate between positive and negative actions, ignorance of karma, and ignorance of the ultimate nature of our own mind, not understanding the reality. And that fundamental ignorance is the root of all suffering and problems. Found from his own experience, and as others have experienced, countless others have experienced since the Buddha taught the Dharma, that suffering, that cause of suffering, can be removed. The cause of suffering is not seeing reality. The antidote is the wisdom. There's a path that leads to the development of the wisdom that sees reality. So by following that path, we can actually escape from the beginning of the cycle of death and rebirth that we're in, and be free of it forever. Liberation or nirvana. So that's a much better goal than just trying to avoid lower rebirth and being born human again. Again, that's done for all our future lives, it's not done for this life. So that's the intermediate level of motivation. It's not ultimate, because it solves only the problem of one person, oneself. It doesn't do much to help all the other living beings who are still left behind in suffering. So the ultimate goal, the highest level of motivation, is to be in a situation where not only we free ourselves, but we free all other living beings, all sentient beings from suffering. And lead them to that highest goal, to that highest goal, enlightenment. And the only way we can do that is by becoming enlightened ourselves. First, we become enlightened, we understand every aspect of the path, and we have the power, wisdom, and compassion to be able to lead others along the path. Many Buddha is leading us and countless others along the path to enlightenment. So with that understanding, then we can generate that highest level of motivation for being here this morning. In brief, we think, you know, the purpose of my life is to lead all sentient beings from suffering to enlightenment. In order to do that, I have to become enlightened first myself. My becoming enlightened depends upon my path. What the path is through study and experience it through practice. So I'm here this morning to study, to learn what the path is, to study the path, and to learn how to put it into practice. In order to reach enlightenment for the sake of all sentient beings. So if that wasn't our motivation for coming here, we got up this morning and made our way here, and at least we can generate that motivation. So we may feel there's a gap between the words and the feeling in our heart. Well, but even if we say those words, it's somehow not really our motivation. But that's just like a beginning thing. If we don't ever verbalize, at least to ourselves, the motivation, then the motivation will never arrive. So it starts with the words and develops through repetition and practice and purification and understanding. Okay, so thanks for coming, everybody. So anyone here for the first time at the center? Okay, a few people. So the actual teachers in India, I'm just kind of faking it here. So bear with me, it's nearly over. As you can see, you know, what we study here is Tibetan Buddhism, and Tibetan Buddhism is really Indian Buddhism as it was transmitted and practiced in Tibet and preserved in Tibet after for 1,000 years after it finished in India. And His Holiness the Dalai Lama likes to call it the Nalanda tradition. Nalanda was one of the great Indian monastic universities. Philosophers studied and practiced and wrote and taught. So their teachings are kind of the core of Tibetan Buddhist teachings. There are, you know, the various different Tibetan Buddhist traditions. There are four main ones. The one we study here is the Gelug tradition, which is the tradition in which the Holiness the Dalai Lama teaches and practices. And that there's a, there's the Nalanda masters, there's a painting up there to the right of the text, the upper one, that shows Monsongkapa, the founder of our tradition, and the 17 of the Nalanda tradition. Anyway, it doesn't matter. So, there were two vehicles of Buddhism, the lesser vehicle and the great vehicle, the Hinayana and the Mahayana. Tibetan Buddhism is the Mahayana, and of the two Mahayana vehicles, the Paramityana and the Vajrayana, this is mainly the Vajrayana. So, you know, we can't cover the whole thing here, so just mention those terms. There are lots of books out there that you can, there's some free books even. You can, if you're not familiar with tradition, you can grab some of those. Three sort of goals that the practitioner on the path goes for or passes through. There's better future lives within cyclic existence, the suffering realm of death and rebirth that we're currently in. There's freedom from that, nirvana or liberation, and there's the supreme enlightenment that was attained by the Buddha, and that's what we're trying to reach ourselves. As unlikely as it might seem. So it takes a while, but we're setting out on the path. So on the Mahayana vehicle, both the Paramityana, the perfection vehicle, and the Vajrayana, the like diamond vehicle, the quick path, the tantric vehicle to enlightenment, which is based on the perfection vehicle. The what we're trying to develop is the supreme motivation that we just tried to generate before, called bodhicitta, the mind of enlightenment, or the determination to reach enlightenment for the sake of all sentient beings. That's the essence of the Mahayana. That's the door to the Mahayana, developing that mind, and that mind is rooted in great compassion. Compassion is all sentient beings, equally to be free from suffering. And that arises from understanding the suffering of sentient beings, and that understanding of sentient beings suffering arises from understanding our own suffering, our own beginningless suffering in cyclic existence. So we try in the Mahayana to reach enlightenment, we try and develop the bodhicitta motivation, the determination. Bodhicitta is the Sanskrit word bodhi, B-O-D-H-I, is D-A, C-H-I-T-T-A, bodhicitta. It means mind, so the enlightenment mind. So that's what we're trying to generate as the entrance to the path to enlightenment. And of course that's based on the earlier teachings, such as teachings on refuge and karma. So the regular Sunday morning teachings that are being, have been given here by our teacher, Yeshe Tenley. We'll be traditional. At that time, everybody hear me. He's been teaching this text, Liberation in the Palm of Your Hand, for a number of years now. I'm going through it in great detail, very carefully, very slowly, and he's in India receiving teachings from His Holiness the Dalai Lama right now. That's why I'm here. So this book, Liberation in the Palm of Your Hand, for those not familiar, this explains the entire stages of the path to enlightenment that we study and practice here. So he's been teaching it for a few years, about halfway through maybe. What is it, refuge or something now? Karma? So about halfway through probably. So, start again. So that's how it works, you have to go through it again and again. So there are, there are short lam-rim teachings, just in 10, 15, 20 verses. So also it's recommended that we, every day, we do a glance meditation on those short lam-rim teachings. It just takes a minute or two if you just want to read through it. Or then there are, ones that are, half this size and a quarter of this size and so on. There are many different ones. But this is kind of our life's work. So the lam-rim, great lam-rim. Lam-rim means stages of the path. So that extensive text was written by Lama Tsongkhapa, the founder of our tradition here. So there are three volumes of this. And this one that we're just thinking about this couple of weeks is volume two. And then one of our teachers who just passed away a few months ago, Yeshe Zopa, over two or three decades, gave extensive commentary to this at his center, five volumes of his commentary on these three volumes. And three have come out and there are two more to come. Three have come out and there are two more. Steps on the path to enlightenment. So, so there's a lot to learn and understand and put into practice. And enlightenment is not an easy state of mind to attain. So, takes quite a bit of effort, and the effort has to be based in knowledge. So the knowledge now is really available, and this is definitely a life's work, you know? Several life's work. So this Pabongarim Sha's teaching, which was given in 1921, nuns and lay people, this is based on Tsongkhapa's long great lam-rim. But this is the one that modern lamas teach, because a large part of this is preliminary practices. So, you know, this is kind of, in a way, more for beginners. This one, the third, this is the second volume of three. The third volume of this is a much bigger volume, and talks about development of concentration and wisdom, six perfections, which is what I'm supposed to be talking about these Sunday mornings. So that part only takes up a relatively small section of this book. This book is weighted at the beginning, and Lama Tsongkhapa's is weighted at the end. So there are two more volumes of commentary to come from Geshe Zopa. The fourth one will be on, I believe, on concentration, development of single point of concentration, mental quiescence, and the fifth one beyond development of wisdom, something like that. So you can see that the different emphasis of these different texts. Okay, so that's the sales pitch. Now to try and deal with what we're supposed to be dealing with here. So there are six perfections. So one, we're trying to develop bodhicitta, the determination. But one, we can develop the determination. But then what do? We have to translate that determination, that motivation, to reach enlightenment into practice. So we have to know what to do with that motivation. So there are a lot of different things to do. But kind of the essence of the bodhisattva's practice is the six transcendent qualities of mind, the perfections of giving, or charity, or generosity, different words in English used to translate them, morality, or discipline, or ethics, patience, or forbearance, enthusiastic perseverance or effort, and concentration and wisdom, the six. So last week we started talking about the first one, the perfection of charity or generosity. So just to recap. So, just to recap briefly what I touched on last week, was the meaning of charity. Practicing charity means having the will to dedicate our body, possessions and merit to others, and make our actions of our body, speech and mind with that virtuous impulse. So dedicating our body, we can understand in different ways. As I mentioned, you know, it can actually mean to a hungry tiger. We're not ready for that. But at least we can try and use our body to benefit others. So by making the things that we do, or we can physically or verbally help others at least, so that we can also, we can use our body for our own selfish purposes, or we can use it to try and benefit others. So we've been using it for our own selfish purposes since beginningless time, if you can get your mind around that concept. And it really hasn't helped because, we're still drowning in the swamp of suffering. So maybe it's time to try something else and really try and dedicate everything we do to the benefit of others, helping hungry people, give shelter to those who are homeless, or food to those who are hungry, medicine to those who are sick, and so forth. And those are good things to do, but it also means helping others understand the suffering situation and trying to give them the tools that they can use to lead themselves out of suffering into better lives. And that's ultimately how the Buddha's teachings work. Even though countless other beings have reached enlightenment, and all they want is, we have to do it for ourselves. So the only way they can really help is by explaining that enlightenment exists. Anybody can attain it, because we all have the spark of enlightenment with in the core of our mind, the clear light nature of mind. It's just temporarily obscured by delusions and subtle obscurations. So these obscurations, gross and subtle, can be removed. So the teaching is how to remove it, and we have to remove it for ourselves. If the Buddhas could do it for us, we'd already be enlightened. But we're not. So that the Buddha helps us by showing the path. Here it is. Then it's up to us to follow the path if we want to. So dedicating our body and our possessions, we can understand dedicating our possessions to others. That's a pretty easy concept to grasp. A little harder to do in practice. Continue. Dedicating our merits. That's something that's, if you're not familiar with Buddhism, but even if we are familiar, at sort of beginning level, it's really hard, a little bit hard to understand what merit is and how to dedicate it. So in a way, we don't feel that we have merit, or we don't know what they are, or we don't even know where they are, even though they're in the bank or where. And we don't have a feeling how precious they are. I think later on the path, as we have a better understanding of what merit is and how much we've accumulated and how much there is to accumulate, there's a danger, I think, of becoming attached to it. So this is, in a way, sort of try to do in our, childish, weak, sort of pathetic way now. But it's sort of plants the seeds for doing it properly later. And I think the bodhisattvas, who have vast amounts of merit, they may feel like, oh, I've worked so hard to get this, do I really have to dedicate and give it to others? Maybe that's a higher practice. I don't know, I'm just making this up, I haven't heard anyone say that, but just thinking about it. And what merit is, and you know, Lama Zopa Rinpoche often stresses how important it is to accumulate merit, how that without merit nothing good can happen. The room or the world. You know, some people are a lot better off than others. So we ask, why is that? What did they, you know, people who, you know, have really easy, prosperous, wealthy lives, you know, what did they do that we didn't do, that, you know, we have to struggle to and work hard just to survive, you know, just to make enough money to buy food and clothing and HBO and stuff, you know. So, essentials. And when we look at that, say, well, they were born, they had good, they were born in the family, or they worked hard, or they got the breaks, or, you know, we look at these kind of superficial reasons, but it doesn't, that doesn't really, actually, that doesn't explain it, you know. And, you know, of course, it can all be lost in a moment, too. So just looking at people and wealth, for example, you know, wealthy people, you know, either, you know, their business was very successful, other people's business, I mean, there are different ways you can accumulate, get wealth. The actual reason is what we call merit or good karma, that that person created the cause, probably in a previous life. But as you know, as one of my friends once said, you know, the central philosophy of Buddhism is it's all your own fault. So that's kind of summing up karma. You know, when bad things happen, we can look around and say, oh, he did it. You know, it's General Motors. I mean, whatever goes wrong, you know. And you get sick or you get killed or whatever. You can find an immediate circumstance behind it. Those are the conditions. Those are secondary causes. There's a principal cause of good things happening and bad things happening. That's karma. So when bad things happen, it's a lack of merit. It's not having enough, you know, positive energy from previous good actions in our mind stream at that particular moment. So, you know, the beginning practice of to create merit, how to generate positive karma, we call it positive karma because everybody wants happiness, nobody wants suffering. Everybody wants happiness, nobody wants suffering. But most people don't have happiness and have a lot of suffering. We have to understand what suffering is too. It's not as simple as it sounds. So the beginning practice is to understand what actions result. So since we want happiness, and certain actions become the principal cause of that, we call that positive karma, because it's the action and the result are sort of in accord. And negative karma, we don't want suffering. So actions that bring suffering, we call negative actions, negative karma. And what is it that determines what's the main thing that determines whether an action is positive or negative, in the cause of suffering, cause of happiness? It's the motivation. So that's why that's always... And it has to be done consciously. Because if we sort of run our lives on automatic pilot, as we normally do, we've been acting out of ignorance and generating from that root, attachment and anger and then all the other branch negative minds that leave negative imprints on our consciousness that ripen into suffering. We've been operating like that since beginning of time. So that's our kind of default mode. It's going to continue. And you know, here we are, we've got a human life, things aren't too bad, we have HBO and stuff. So it's not that bad. This is like such a small window into reality that it's, barely worth looking through. I mean, if you think beginningless and endless time, and 50, 60, 80, 100 years, compared to infinity, it's nothing, is it? But that's what we always, with our incredible sort of tunnel vision, kind of look at all the time, just focused on such a narrow aspect of reality. So if we put all our energy into that, when that finishes, as it inevitably does, we're left with nothing going forward. Not left with nothing, because we have, an accumulation of positive and negative karma from beginningless time, but nearly all of it's negative. So if you look around, you think, oh, there's a lot of people in the world, human rebirth is considered a good result, there's, like 7 billion. Well, of those 7 billion, there's a lot of lives that you wouldn't want to have anyway, and they're not much, but the vast, still, those 7 billion human lives are the result of a cause. They're the result of positive karma created in previous lives. Obviously previous lives, because they're born human. But then you look just on this earth, which you see on the internet. This is where we are. You see this tiny dot in this vast expanse of black, and then you go out and you see all the size of the Earth and all the other planets and infinite space and other galaxies and all this stuff. So not only is this like a tiny, this is a tiny physical space in the infinity of space. So even here, just looking what we can see on Earth, and all we see, of course, are humans and animals. We don't really see other planes of existence, like the God realms or the spirit. Some people see spirits, not very often, hungry ghosts, and we don't see the hell realms. And of course, you know, our tendency is if we don't see it, it doesn't exist, but that's not really a valid criterion. So just looking here, 7 billion people, 7 billion good results, but how many trillions of animals and insects and, you know, sea creatures and, you know, birds and all the other life forms, just in the animal realm, we can see. Of course, there are loads of them we can't see. They're way down the bottom of the ocean, or they're too small, they're microscopic. So if we just look at just those two, the human and the animal realm, just on this earth, what we can see, number of animals. So looking at humans in terms of karmic, being karmic results, why is there that imbalance? It's because negative karma is so much easier to create. We do it all the time without thinking. That's why there's so many in the animal world. And there are many more spirits, hungry ghosts, than there are animals. And there are many more hell beings than hungry ghosts. So even thinking of the lower realms, the animal, which is so many, is just the tip of the iceberg there. So it's like that because it's so much easier to create the cause of a lower rebirth than an upper, you know, especially a human rebirth like the one we have, where we have the opportunity, the leisure and the opportunity to, you know, meet and study and understand and practice the Dharma, you know, the teaching that explains the nature of existence and the way to create, you know, a perfect future for ourselves and others. So if we want to be born human, we need to create the cause. And if we want good things to happen when we're human, we need to create the cause of those as well. And those positive causes we call merit. So why there are people, very rich people, is because they created the cause for that wealth in previous lives. And even though they might have gone through emotions, you know, like being a celebrity or an actor or a successful musician or something, made a lot of money. That's again just the, that's the, those are the conditions. The actual cause was the potential to become wealthy, and that potential to become wealthy, what they did in previous lives is they practiced generosity one way around, is giving. You were saying, if you give, you shall receive. Where is that? Is that from the Bible or something? Mm-hmm. There you go.
To give is to receive is to give.
Well, that's ideally that's what we want to do, you know. And you know, we see a lot of wealthy people who are very miserly and don't give their money, and they're very and use it all on themselves. That's creating the cause not to have those advantages again. The best use of possessions, as little or as much as we have, to create more merit, and not just for the sake of, again, for having even more wealth in the future, but in order to develop a great store of merit to reach enlightenment. I mean, there are um, You know, to reach enlightenment, there are kind of two I'm not sure how to say this. Two kind of streams of energy that we have to develop. And in the Buddhist terms, it's called wisdom and merit. There are two collections we have: a collection or accumulation of wisdom, and the accumulation or perfection of merit. So these are, in a way, summed up by these six perfections. The five perfections of, generosity, morality, patience, effort, and concentration. Those are on the method, on the merit side. And the collection of wisdom is the sixth perfection, the perfection of wisdom. So accumulation of, so that's all, this accumulation of merit is also called method. Because you see, you have to practice two things together, method and wisdom. So method, a lot of other things, but summarized in those five. And wisdom is wisdom, understanding, you know, the understanding, like I said before, the wisdom understands karma and the wisdom understands the ultimate nature of reality. So the end result of those, the result of the accumulation of the perfection of these five method or merit perfections is to have the body of the Buddha. And the end result of the accumulation of wisdom is to have the mind of the Buddha, the omniscient mind of the Buddha. So there's the enlightened holy mind, the omniscient mind of the Buddha, and there's the and then the, so that's called the Dharmakaya. The kaya is a Sanskrit word for holy body. So the holy body of the Dharma or knowledge or wisdom. And there's the Rupakaya, the holy body of form. So that has two aspects. One is called the Sambhogakaya, which is the sometimes translated as the enjoyment body. So that is specifically for higher level bodhisattvas. So when we talk about, you know, bodhisattvas' practice of the six perfections, actually the bodhisattva, once you generate bodhicitta, there are sort of 10 levels of 10 bodhisattva levels. So these are the sort of the gradual development of a bodhisattva towards enlightenment through these 10 levels. So there are 7 what we call ordinary levels, that we are 3 pure levels, 8, 9, and 10, which are out of psychic existence. So the Sambhogakaya, this body of Buddha, exists to guide the pure level bodhisattvas from where they are to the rest of enlightenment. So very, kind of, a bit too refined for us. But, so that's Sambhogakaya. The other aspect of the Buddha's body is called the Nirmanakaya, or the transformation body. So that's like Shakyamuni Buddha. That's manifest to guide and can be seen by ordinary sentient beings. bodies of the Buddha are the result of the practice of these five, the first five perfections. So gradually accumulating more and more positive, more and more merit for practicing as a bodhisattva on the basis of bodhicitta motivation, charity, morality, patience, effort, concentration, and then the practice of wisdom leads to the Dharmakaya, the mind of the Buddha. So coming back to us, it's like the beginning of the practice, we have to understand the difference between negative and positive motivation. And if we don't understand and we let ourselves go, we just create more negative karma. And the creation of positive karma necessarily involves recognizing negative motivations when they arise, and then at least intellectually, displacing them with a positive motivation. No, I'm not going to follow that. I'm going to do this speech, enlightened for the sake of all sentient beings. That way we can gradually sort of move the scales more and more, less than we created in previous lives. We have to purify by various means. But the main thing is not to create, at least not to create more. So, dedicating body possession and merits to others. So, understanding merit isn't a simple thing. So, and accumulating it is even more difficult. So, it's something we need to pay attention to. So, we talked about how to follow charity and practicing charity with all perfections. So, we talked about how all the perfections. Then we talked about practicing charity with the bodhicitta. There were mentioned six holy things: holy possessions, holy purpose, holy skill, holy dedication, holy purity. Then practicing with the four actions, dedicating our body to all sentient beings from our heart, and having dedicated it, protecting it from being wasted in meaningless actions, purifying, making charity of our body a pure practice by concentrating on the circle of the three. Remember we mentioned that? When giving, there are three aspects. There's the person giving, there's the action of giving, and there's the recipient. So recognize each is devoid of inherent existence. There is no giver without the action of giving and a recipient. And there is no action of giving without a giver and a recipient. And there is no recipient without a giver and the action of giving. And then increasing by dedicating the merit and giving to all sentient beings. So we talked about that. And then the main thing, divisions of charity. And we talked about three. Remember? What are the three kinds of giving?
Giving dharma, material.
Freedom from fear.
Fearlessness, yeah. Back to the drawing board.
Yeah,
so that's important. There are three kinds of giving. So it's material giving, which we all understand, hopefully we do. And of course, this time of year, this kind of shows that the degenerate times we live in, because okay, December the 31st is fast approaching. You've got to do your giving now to get a tax deduction. If you, I don't know exact numbers, but most charities, we call them charities because they're recipient non-profits, you know, there was registered with the IRS to receive tax deductible donations. Most of them get most of their money around this time of the year. It's kind of sick. But you know, but that's also, you know, that's, you know, we're so kind of ignorant of the benefits of giving that we need these kind of sweeteners to write a check. You know, tax deduction, oh my God, I've only got one more day to get my deduction, you know. If I do it on the 1st of January, I have to wait, you know, another whole year, you know. So people, I mean, you know, of course, if you're a recipient, if you're running a non-profit, it's, you play that to the hilt, but, you know, like the centre, you know, I mean, this is the time to make donations to Kurukulla Center, folks, because you get a tax deduction. You know? From the merit point of view, you get the same amount of merit whether you give it in January or December. But, so you think, well, if that's the case, I may as well get a tax deduction as well. You know, there's that side of it. There's also the premiums side. You know, you have to offer, you know, if you give $1,000, you'll get this. And if you give $500, you'll get that. And if you give $20, then you'll get that. I mean, so there's all these inducements that we need to give more, you know. When we were back in the late 90s, when we were really trying to raise the money, Kurukulla Center, to buy our own place, we didn't have this place, we only got this in 2000. You know, we've been trying for a while. We're having teachings at the Friends Meeting House in Harvard Square. Nice place, but not ours. It fit in a Tupperware box. You know, so you bring out a little table and you say, did you just go there? You went around there? So, put up a little table, put a statue and a couple of things on it, you know, at the end, pack it up and put it in a box and shove it under the stairs, along with the cushions, you know. So we asked, at one point we asked Lama, Zopa, you know, what do you think if there were some obstacles to our getting out, you know, do we have the merit to buy, did we have the centre members, do we have the collective merit, you know, to buy a centre? And he said, well, if you're in a great lama who'd been imprisoned for a long time in Tibet and came out in the 80s, actually one of the last, he's gone now, they all, pretty much all have, he was last living personal disciples of the Vonga Rinpoche who wrote this book, Ribush. If you invite him to Boston to give teachings, that will remove obstacles. Mm-hmm. So we invited him for 2 or 3 years. Finally he came, I think in about 99, something like that. And he gave some teachings. We rented some places around Harvard Square here and there. And he gave, I think he gave 4 or 5 days teaching, some initiations and so on. And then we had he stayed with Western at the time, and Rinpoche stayed there. And then we had a community meeting, so a bunch of Kurukulla people came over, we had dinner with him, and then we asked his advice. You know, he said, well, Lama Zopa Rinpoche said that if you come, then we'll be able to buy a center. So, you know, lay it on us. So he was kind of, you know, he didn't have really much specific to say. But one thing he said, so in Tibet, he said it's very important that everybody works together. He emphasized the need for, you know, harmony and cooperation within the community. And, I mean, there were, you know, 20 of us, maybe 15, 20, 25 of us, there weren't that many. The one key thing he said that I think really, in a way, caused this center to manifest. He said, in Tibet, you know, when, you know, people who were working for a salary, and I don't know how many there were then, but he said, when people got paid for doing a job, whether it was a salary or whatever it was, you know, when they received money, the first thing they did was they put aside a certain portion for making offerings. Before rent, before food, before clothing, before anything. The most important thing to do with, to make sure, that it was number one priority, to make sure they had enough money to sponsor teachings, to, you know, buy statues or tankas or whatever, I mean, whatever they did, but it was to make offerings to their teachers. So, and, you know, that's kind of the idea of tithing, I guess. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what percentage, I guess people did different percentages, I don't know. But then we thought, well, okay, let's run with this idea. So we figured we wanted to try and raise $500,000. So we thought if, and I don't know, these figures are approximate now, I can't remember exactly, but we thought if we got 20 or 25 people to commit to give 10% 5 years, not for the rest of their life, just for 5 years. And we figured out each person would give 5,000, I think maybe 20 people. 20 people giving 5,000 a year for 5 years. Is that $500,000?
Let's give me to that.
So then we said, okay, let's, and also, so we, it may not have been, I think it was 25 people giving maybe 4,000, whatever it was. And the deal was that if you make a commitment and we don't get 24 other people, you're off the hook. We had to have that critical mass, you know. So then we started asking people, nobody wanted to give 10%. So what people did say is, no, I don't know if I can commit to that, but I can commit to 2,000 a year. So people started naming numbers. So I can give this much, I can give this much, and one person said, well, I'll sell some shares, I'll give 50,000 right away, and that just one time, you know. So somehow we managed that way to see that we'd have a couple of 100,000. So then we had the official launch, and then someone had been looking at buildings. Anyway, eventually we got this place. So the spark of that idea came from Ribush Rinpoche saying that the most important thing for people in Tibet when they got paid was to put, the first part of their money was to put aside to give away. So you can call that material charity, it is material charity, but then depending on what you, if you give it to sponsor teachings, that's also giving the Dharma, you know. So the three kinds of giving, material charity, so of the three, that's kind of the lowest. I mean, it's still very important, but it's More beneficial than that is giving a fearlessness. Fearlessness is saving the lives of others. You know. Um, releasing people from prison. Now, you know, if I'm not quite sure to be released. People who are kind of guilty and going to do it again, maybe they shouldn't, I don't know. It's like, so anyway, we don't have much power to release people from prison anyway. Although, you know, we can support the Innocence Project or, you know, these DNA things. You just find so many people who've been unjustly convicted. Anybody listen to Serial?
Mm-hmm.
The podcast?
Yeah.
Who said you?
I did, back here.
Did he do it or not?
I don't think so. But
did
who did?
That's the question, isn't it?
What do you think?
I don't know. I'm with Sarah Koenig. I don't know. Anyway, so, but, you know, there are situations where, you know, people are railroaded into prison and maybe they shouldn't be there, so that's good to release them, you know. We see all the time insects drowning in puddles. Maybe we'll just walk past. It's better to stop. I mean, think, imagine if it was you. Wouldn't you want someone to, if you were a little insect drowning in a puddle, you want to live, you want to be happy, you don't want suffering. So take it out with a leaf or gently, you know, not to. Sometimes, of course, it's hard to do it without harming. You know, like if this fly is caught in a spider's web, maybe it's too late, you know. Well, maybe it's not. Still, I think maybe it's worth making the effort. They said, well, what about the spider? The spider has to eat. You know, this is the dilemma of cyclic existence. I remember, but saving lives of others, you know, that's what we, so we do these animal liberations often, you know. We'll here at the centre, we'll go up to Gloucester and somewhere where hopefully they won't be caught. But before we release them, we put a lot of Dharma imprints. You know, we do recite mantras, and we circumambulate them around holy objects like stupa and texts and to give them imprints. So even if they do die, at least they have some mental connection with the Dharma established in their consciousness. That's even more important than actually saving their life, because everyone's going to die anyway. But if you die with positive imprints, much better than being bereft, you know. So, Lama Zopa Rinpoche was saying, you know, he was in Singapore, and one of them in particular, he has organized the release of 180 million living beings, mainly seafood. Seafood, sea creatures. But, you know, you go to this, you know, either they're, you know, shellfish or lobsters or all kinds of things. You go and buy them from the restaurants, whatever, then you give them imprints and then you release them. 170, 180 million. Lama Zopa was at a restaurant in Singapore and there was a snake in a tank, you know, waiting for someone. What do? You grill it? Well, no, you eat snake, but you let them eat snake. But so he said, oh, let's buy the snake, we'll free the snake. So they bought the snake, and then they take it out and said, well, now we're going to put the snake in the forest, and it's going to eat mice.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, that's what they eat. You know, they don't eat porridge. So, and who's going to cook for them if they do? So it was this, it's this dilemma we find ourselves in. Like, you know, another way I think of saving sentient beings' lives is by becoming vegan. You know, being veg and dairy. You know, for every milk tortured cow, there's a male calf that was killed because it was useless. Or for every egg-laying hen, there's a male chick that was ground up alive or gassed, because they don't, you know, the egg-laying ones aren't suitable for meat. So they separate the females from the males and they kill the males right away, you know. So so I think one way of saving animals from suffering and death is by vegetables. You know, so many insects. If you eat rice, you know, how many living beings die for a bowl of rice, which is, you know, pretty vegan. You know how rice is grown? So there's a rice paddy, you know. So say the last crop is harvested, so the land stays like that, and then kind of insects and worms and things go in there. Then when it's ready to plant the next crop, they go in and they dig it up. So a lot of beings get killed just when the earth is dug up, like any field, for growing stuff. So then they flood, then they plant the seedlings for the rice, you know, and then over a few months, whatever it is, then, you know, the things grow, and other insects come live in the water. So then when it's time to harvest the rice, they drain the water out, so they all die. And then there's other ones living in the mud, so as it's pulled up, they get trampled and so on. So then the rice is winnowed or whatever they do, and then they put it into bags, and then they put it in a truck, and the truck drives it somewhere, and as the truck's going along, it's kind of killing insects and frogs on the road and stuff, you know. And the truck was made of rubber, it's got rubber and metal, and that was all mined, so other sentient thing. I mean, it never ends. And that's for one crop of rice. That rice came from previous, through this cycle. So when you're sitting there with one bowl of, you know, your vegan rice, and how many millions or billions of sentient beings died for that, going back in time? Yeah, so...
But you have to put it in a proper proportion as well. I mean, if you look at the famine that exists, wouldn't you say that by the hand that feeds the other, there is what you extract today from the teaching, the medicine to defatigue people by the nature of being nourished? Isn't it the heart space of nourishing with love, with compassion, which is the compassion of the beautiful teaching of great beings who show us the river of life, of how you want to swim the current of this defeminization, and not live by guilt? So not live by guilt. So here you are in this earth, in this exquisite planet that gives you the fragrance of food, the fragrance of flowers, the fragrance of a human heart. Wouldn't say that feeding people would be one of the main answer. First, to defatigue people. If when people are poor, you use it wisely. You use it wisely. As a wealthy or poor, you use wisely this extraordinary food. So, of course, there's discernment. But when you see a child, a baby, that is not fed, you have to be very strong to help yourself with your own karma.
Well, you're right. It's like
this hen has to feed. The moment you feed someone with milk, when I lived in Africa, I was so excited to receive milk every day. So it's cow, not cow. All I can share is that this moment for a child of innocence, to receive this milk, powdered milk from America, the generous America, beautiful milk of powder, thousands of children being receiving from the hand, and that medicine goes right inside these defective people. It makes you able to do certain things in your physicality, which is, I don't know this word in Buddhism, inherent existent, big words. Simplicity.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think this is the point I'm trying to get to. It's not black and white. I mean, we have to help others as best we can. At the same time, we should try and do as the least amount of harm as possible in helping others. So that was kind of the dilemma of being eaten, but then the consequence is that. So the bottom line is, whatever we do, we should try and do as little harm as possible, but in the end, the only real solution is to escape from cyclic existence altogether and lead others out. So, you know, it's like we're all, you know, there are thousands and thousands of people, say, drowning in a big lake, and you discover how to swim, so you make your way to the edge. Now, you can try and drag someone with you from the middle, but that's maybe you're both going to finish up drowning. So best is get yourself out and then pull out others from the edge. So those who are close, you know, it's like that. Now, your intention may be just to save yourself, to lie on the bank and say, oh, no, I'm okay, and forget about the others screaming and drowning, you know. Or you can, your whole intention is the best way to help myself and others is to get out and help them out. So someone looking at you swimming for the edge can say, wow, look at that person, so compassionate, going to get out and help the others. Or can say, look at that person, so selfish, just trying to save himself. You know? You don't know what's in another person's mind. Anyway, the thing is that we do need to get ourselves out and then help pull others out once we're on firm ground. And, you know, you can get out by clambering over and drowning all these other people on the way, or you can work your way skillfully through. I haven't even started today.
Have you finished generosity? So.
No, we haven't. No. Are you kidding? So the charity of fearlessness and then the charity of Dharma. So that's, you know, as I said, you know, trying to explain the teachings or supporting teachings being given, you know, sponsoring books, giving away books, working for a Dharma center. There are many different ways that we can help. You know, we can learn to paint tankas, you know, or make statues so that we can give them as objects of devotion. Since people's main problem is ignorance of Dharma, the best way to solve that is, the best way to solve people's main problem is by giving them the Dharma. So that's why that's considered the highest form of charity. And that clock's slow. And material charity, giving food, giving what people need to survive, medicine and so on. That money, that's very important. But even more than that is giving fearlessness. And then there are not sharp demarcations because, you know, you give them food, whatever they need, whatever's available, and you save their life. So that's also charity of fearlessness. But anyway, these are the three main divisions of charity. And that's the end of today.
So you're saying fear is the main one, helping them out, fear is the main one?
No,
is
Dharma.
Is that what you're saying? Because you said fear and then
charity,
it's
Charity, fearlessness, and Dharma.
Okay.
Three divisions.
Okay.
So, you know, the so-called lowest is material charity. That's kind of the easiest to do, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Fearlessness is a little more difficult. Dharma is more difficult. And more Dharma is the most beneficial. Saving other life beneficial than helping out in a terrible temporal situation. But it's important to do all of them.
Okay.
We just need to understand the different ways we can help others and the relative merits.
It's just like consider three categories.
Yes. Okay, so, sorry, we didn't really do much today, but that's how it is. So, you know, we generated the bodhicitta, the highest motivation at the beginning, and during this session we tried to talk about Buddha's teachings so that action was harmonious with the intention. So now, because we've generated a good amount of merit, and that protects it from being destroyed by anger, wrong views, and so on that we might generate in the future. And that undedicated merit is susceptible to destruction by it. So we just think what we're doing. We've created merit. We want to prevent it from being destroyed, like, you know, seed being burnt and losing its potential. So we want it to maintain its potential, so right away we offer it to others, to the enlightenment of all sentient beings. So that's what we're doing, and we do it in the form of certain prayers and so on. So, here, just do the quick one again. Dedication, the bodhicitta, long life prayers, and no need to do the mandala, and then we can just do the mid-tema. So what page?
Page
57.
Page 75.
Tomorrow we have the Tara Puja, the usual spot, 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock. Yep, even though there's, you know, it's the New Year's week, we still have our pujas, which is wonderful. On New Year's Day itself, we have a Lama Chopa Guru Puja that's going to run from 7 o'clock. Usually they run about until 8:30, 45. Then we're going to have just a small community potluck, whoever's there, whoever can make it. Just if you come, just bring something simple. The idea is just bread, soup, you know, some snacks, nothing elaborate, but just kind of to have in the year with the community coming together, if it's at all. So that's Wednesday night. And then on Thursday itself, we have at 10 o'clock, we do a group reading of the Golden Light Sutra to just kick off the new year again with a wonderful action that generates a lot of merit. The other thing to note about the Golden Light Sutra is that Lama Zopa Rinpoche has said that us reading the Golden Light Sutra amongst the community, just, you know, a part of your studies, it is extremely, it will be extremely good for the support of the center and for any other new activities and even for our existing activities just to flourish. So if you guys can do that, and then also in the newsletter, there's always a link. Zopa Rinpoche did the full teaching in Australia, along a retreat of 4 weeks session, which means if you listen to that, he does it in Tibetan, you get the imprints, but you then will be able, when you recite the Golden Light Sutra, it has so much more merit and power that comes from your recitation. So I know it's about a 5-hour thing, but you can do and pause and do and pause. Little plug for that. I think it's a wonderful thing. We will have class tomorrow night for everyone's interested. Just the usual Shion class, but I'm leading it. Just also taking people through some meditations. And then, as Nick said, we really appreciate any donations for the center. As you know, we're giving the Dharma, and still we need to pay the bills. Well, thanks everyone.
Thank you.